This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have a great episode for you today. It's titled, 8 Tips to Developing a High-Performance Team. Well, I think you're going to benefit greatly from this episode, but before we get to that, 2 quick announcements to make. Coming up in January, we have our first masterclass for 2023. That masterclass is titled, 6 Steps to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans. That masterclass is 3 hours, one evening, 3 hours, is done virtually in a live stream format, 3 hours in length, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time. And in that masterclass, I go through very specifically each step. There's 6 steps to successfully resign from PPO plans. This is a masterclass that we developed from my coaching work in terms of helping hundreds of offices to successfully drop PPO plans. If that's on your agenda, if you're even interested in just peeking your head under the tent and seeing what that might be like, come join us for that masterclass. Very inexpensive. Tuition is less than $100. You get 3 hours of CE credits. It's done virtually in a live stream format so that you can attend from the comfort and convenience of your home or office. However, it's done in a live format, live stream. It's not recorded. It's done live stream so that you can interact with me and ask questions as we go along. That way you can make it as meaningful as possible. If you'd like to register, go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. We do limit attendance to the masterclasses. Even though it's done virtually, we limit attendance because I run it more like a workshop than a lecture. If you go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass, if there's seats available, I encourage you to jump on it and come join us in January of 2023 for this first masterclass. The next announcement I have is we have a returning guest with a top clinical tip. You've heard him before, and we've invited him back due to popular request, Dr. Pavel Krestev, and he's going to talk about implant dentistry, and in particular, he's going to talk about the restorative aspect of implant dentistry. He always has great tips. You're going to enjoy this one.
Hello, dear friends and colleagues, and thanks again to the Thriving Dentist Organization for giving me this opportunity yet again to share a clinical tip that I think can benefit your practices. So today's tip is going to be related to implant dentistry, and more specifically to the reconstruction aspect of implant dentistry. And I will share a very basic thing that I do that helps me tremendously in the rare event where this occurs, which I will explain momentarily. So I think as dentists who restore implants and who place implants, we very often get a dreaded phone call, and the patient says to you, Doc, my implant is loose. So initially, most of us don't like to hear that. However, it's perfectly normal for this to occur, and it will occur if you are involved in implant dentistry. So once you have the initial heart attack and you say, oh my God, an implant is failing, usually, it's not the implant itself failing, it's simply a loose abutment screw. So in most cases, take a deep breath when you get that phone call and patient says the implant is loose and relax and say to yourself that you will evaluate the situation and usually remedy it relatively easily by simply retorquing in the prosthesis. So the trick that I'm going to explain is whenever I insert an abutment and a crown or multiple crowns, I always take a photograph of the abutments. I remove the crowns, I set them aside, I put the model on the table, and I simply take a photograph of the occlusal aspect. This way I know where all the abutment access holes are. Okay, sometimes they can be straight up, sometimes they're on the side, sometimes we use custom abutments, etc. So in order for making the fixing to the problem easier, it gives you a map that you know on a particular patient where the access holes are on each individual tooth that you've restored. And I usually, once I take the photograph of the abutments, I place it in the patient chart and I have it there for reference. So when you do get the phone call, patient comes in, now you you explain to the patient, obviously you take an x-ray, you probe, you evaluate what's going on. And in most cases, you will realize that it's not the actual implant that's failing or that's loose, it's the actual prosthesis. Typically, this occurs over time. In many systems, especially in systems that don't form a cold weld between the abutment and implant interface. But that's another conversation. So very briefly, take an x-ray, make sure the implant is stable. And now your job is to find where that the access should be made on the tooth in order to get to the screw. So hence, you open the chart for that particular patient and you examine the photograph that you took previously when you inserted the case. So now you at least know where you should do your access. And the access itself is very similar in many cases to an endodontic access that you guys are all used to doing. And then you have to find the screw. When looking for the screw, rather for the abutment with the access hole to the screw, make sure you use copious irrigation, a lot of water, to cool the ceramic restoration so you don't fracture the porcelain. The other thing that I like to do whenever I'm faced with this part of dentistry is I explain to the patient that I will do my best to find the screw without damaging the prosthesis. But unfortunately, in some cases, the ceramics can fracture. And in that scenario, then we need to make a whole new prosthesis. But in conclusion, make it a habit. No matter whether you're inserting a single unit or a full mouth case, take that photograph, that at least you will be aided in where to start the access preparation for the screw location. All right, my peeps, thank you very much. And thanks again to the Thriving Dentist Organization. I hope this tip helps in your clinical everyday practices. Thank you very much.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. First, I want to take a moment to thank Pavel for that wonderful tip. Thank you, Dr. Pavel. And, this is one of those people who many of you liked, and so we are bringing him back. So I hope you enjoy this tip.
You know, Naren, I love his passion for dentistry and his passion for sharing information with others. So, Pavel, thank you so much for being part of the Thriving Dentist Show. We appreciate you.
Absolutely. The topic today is 8 tips to develop a high performance team. 8 tips to developing a high performance team. Gary, this is a passion of yours, right? I know you have dedicated 42 years and perhaps 43 in a couple of weeks by the time this episode airs. So you have spent, a lifetime really understanding high performance teams. I remember the stories you have shared with me about some of your mentors and how, one particular mentor that you mentioned, you said his newest employee was with him for like 25 years. And usually, like when you have people where the employee and the employer has such a long-term relationship, that's a high performance team. So I'm really looking forward to this episode, Gary, about high performance teams.
You know, I'm going to start with a definition. What is a definition of a high performance team? It's when the doctor or doctors, if you have multiple doctors in your practice, like we do at LifeSmiles, it's when the doctor or doctors are in alignment with every team member, all moving together in concert towards commonly defined goals and objectives. So when doctor or doctors are in alignment with every team member, all moving together in concert towards commonly defined goals and objectives. A simpler way to say that, Naren, in a more casual way, is when doctor or doctors and team members are all in the same boat, rowing in the same direction. That's maybe an easier way to say that, less sophisticated way to say that. You know, I've been in practices where the doctors and the team weren't even in the same boat. let alone rowing in the same direction. I've been some that weren't even in the water. They were over here in the beach. And doctor was over here going somewhere else by himself or herself. I'll also make an observation. Naren, I've made it my life's work and passion to studying world-class practices, world-class dental practices. I have yet to meet a world-class dental practice that didn't also have a high-performance team. I've never seen that. I have to be careful using words like always or never, because rarely are absolutes accurate, but I can confidently state that. I have never seen a world-class practice that didn't also have a high-performance team. So they go hand in hand. Now, I've met many dentists that struggle with this over the years, and yet they're exceptional. The dentist, she may be exceptional, but without the high-performance team, she will hit a glass ceiling. She can get so far by herself. Or in fairness, himself. They can only get so far. And they'll hit an artificial glass ceiling. And yet, when you've developed a high-performance team, that artificial glass ceiling is completely removed. And quite literally, the sky is the limit in terms of what you can do together. Does that make any sense, Darren?
Absolutely. Now you have me even more intrigued. I want that high performance team.
there's nothing easy about this. If you're thinking this is something easy, I hate to dispel. I hate to burst the bubble. There's nothing easy about this, especially at the time we're recording this episode. You know, let's face it. Let's address the pink elephant in the room. It's harder than ever to attract and keep high-quality team members. It's harder than ever. You know, the employment landscaping in dentistry has changed radically in the post-COVID world.
Yes.
I've been doing this now for 42-plus years, and I've seen ebbs and flows in hiring. You know, I remember times there, and this, I have to go back a little ways in history, but I remember times where we place an ad and have 8 or 10 really qualified applicants for a job. And then it was a case of getting to choose from the 8 or 10 really quality applicants. And yet today, there are many practices that have unfilled positions open in their practice. Could be a hygienist, it could be an assistant, it could be an admin team member, could be for an office manager, where you've got ads on Indeed, you've got maybe in Dental Post, maybe on ZipRecruiter, and you're not getting any applications. And so many positions are going unfilled. And that's the reality of hiring today in 2022 and soon to be 2023. Don't give up on that. I do believe it's changing. Naren, are you seeing any winds of change out there? I mean, you interact with a lot of dental offices through Equa. Are you seeing any winds of change?
I think I'm slowly starting to see some changes. Like, for example, I think part of what COVID did is, A, the government pumped a lot of free money. I know it happened in Canada and it happened in the US. Plus, prices went up. Like, home prices were like, 300,000 up, 400,000 up. So people had, quote unquote, extra cash. And that kind of created a mindset of, do I really need it? Is it worth it? Like, all these kind of weird questions. But I think with the interest rates going up and the economy kind of like, even in tech, right, which was like booming like crazy, there's hundreds of thousands of layoffs, every single company. So I think there's
some job openings at Twitter.
75% gone.
75% of the workforce is gone. At Twitter. As we're recording this, maybe that changes, but that's how it is right now.
Yeah. So I think things are starting to change. I think people are getting serious, about the future and working hard, like the core American values, so to speak, hard work. I think those things are coming back. I think we were in this weird phase. I don't know what it is, but this kind of a weird phase that at least I don't remember in my lifetime, during COVID and right after COVID.
Yeah, I think we are seeing people getting back to work, being motivated to get back to work, to be self-sufficient, to go back to some fundamental values that have been in place for years and years and years. And you know, I am an optimist, so you can accuse me of being an optimist, but I am seeing it, you know, in trend lines with our client base in my coaching, where perhaps a hygienist, for example, maybe we lost a hygienist because her spouse got transferred out of state and they had to move. And now I'm starting to see where we'll get multiple applicants for an open hygiene position, where that wasn't true even just a few months ago. So we are seeing that.
Yeah, and also like supply and demand, right? Like even in tech, many companies' revenues are going down, so they need to cut. So same thing I think will eventually happen in dentistry, where the strong will get stronger and the weak will have to cut, which means now the employees need a job. So there will be more applicants.
Yeah. Well, I don't want to sugarcoat it and pretend that it's easy to develop a high-performance team.
Right.
But like my grandmother used to say, Gary, if it was easy, everyone would be doing it. Right. And she was right. So I've got 8 tips, and I'm going to go into those in detail. Let me number them as I go so I can remember to cover all 8. Number 1, create a very strong practice purpose. Very strong practice purpose. Your why. What is your practice about? And in my opinion, it's even more important today to develop a very strong practice purpose, because quality team members want to be involved in something more than themselves. They want to be involved in a cause, in something that's greater than themselves, especially people of the millennial generation, the millennial generation. You know, the millennial generation now, Naren, is our largest generational group. Sometime during the year 2022, they surpassed the baby boomers as the largest group of a generation. Up until sometime in 2022, it was baby boomers. And now what's happening with baby boomers is they're dying. You know, they're reaching an age where they're passing on. And sometime during 2022, the millennials became the largest generational group. And I think millennials can sometimes be maligned there with broad generalizations. But I have a positive generalization I'd like to put on millennials. Millennials often want to be involved in something that's bigger than themselves, something that's cause-based. So creating a very strong practice purpose, what you're all about, can be a magnet to attract the best people in your community, people that want to come work for you because they want to be involved in something. They want to be involved in improving people's lives. You know, so if your purpose is all about, you know, helping people in your community enjoy the benefits of great oral health, where we know that today that's not just related to the health of their teeth and gums, but related to their overall health, and in truly changing the lives of others that we get to interact with, that's a very strong practice purpose. That's a purpose that is like a magnet that draws quality people into your practice. Naren, do you see that?
Oh, absolutely, Gary. I think the purpose is key, because if you don't know where you're going, you're not going to get there. And I love the one of the purposes you have for Life Smiles. You created for Life Smiles with your dental partners, is we want to take care of people like we like to be taken care of. You know, that's, and you talk about technology, you talk about, doing the very best. So I think that rallies people, right? When you are very clear on why you are waking up in the morning, leaving your kids, or making all the sacrifices you're making and coming here, it better be worth it. And at that kind of a purpose, we want to improve the health and smiles of the people in our neighborhood, and we want to take care of people like we want to be taken care of. That's a worthwhile purpose.
And change the life of others. I mean, I think at a fundamental foundation, people want to be helping others. You know, yes. Especially in dentistry, they really want to help change the lives of others.
Right.
So number 1, create a very strong practice purpose. Your why. What is your practice about? Number 2, cultivate a practice culture. Naren, a practice culture is developing it whether you're creating it or not.
Yes.
Do you agree with that?
100%. 100%.
And if you're not driving it, you may end up with the culture that you don't necessarily want.
Right.
So you've got to be in the driver's seat on this. And recently I helped one of our clients develop their own practice culture. And I'm going to read some of the bullet points that was important to this practice. And again, you're welcome to use these or use it as inspiration to create your own practice culture. We aspire to take care of patients the way we would like to be taken care of, clinically and behaviorally. We expect our team members to support one another. We expect you to embrace lifelong learning with the goal of being better tomorrow than you are today. We seek to understand each team member and each patient as a unique person. We work to show compassion, empathy, and acceptance towards each other and our patients. We strive to be non-judgmental. We believe that patients deserve our 100% focus and attention. Distractions are to be checked at the door. We strive to be positive. We work to do our best every day. So there's some elements of a practice culture that you can use as a starting point yourself and develop your own. But that's how we hold ourselves accountable to those cultural components. And that's how we let our expectations be known to our team members. Number three, one of the ways, one of the tips to develop a high-performance team is develop a genuine connection with each and every one of your team members. Now, Aaron, you've heard me talk an awful lot about developing a connection with our patients.
Yes.
That's very important. But it's equally important to develop for the doctor to develop a connection with each and every one of their team members. Would you agree?
100%. I mean, I know one of the meetings you recommend or suggest to your clients is this one-on-one meeting. So every few months or every so often, you want to sit down and listen to the patient. I mean, to the team member. Get to know them. Like, know that they know that you care about them. It's she or he is not just a number or a person who does a task, but they're a human being. The more interested you are in them, the more interested in they are in your practice.
Exactly. The more interested, you said that well, Maren, the more interested you are in them, the more likely they are to be interested in your practice. Absolutely right. How well do you know your team members? Do you know their spouse's name? Do you know what their spouse does for a living? Do you know their kids? Do you know their kids' names? Do you know their dog's name? Do you know their faith? Do you know much about their extended family? Do you know much about their hobbies and interests? In the same way that we want to know those things about our patients, we need to know those things about our team members. And that really changes the dynamic, you know, from, you know, ho-hum another day at work to I'm working with people I genuinely care about.
Right.
Yeah. Number four, make it your mission to develop each team member. Make it your mission, doctor, to develop each team member. How much of a career path do team members have in your practice? And I don't mean just promotions, but ways they can learn more about dentistry. How much of a career path? I mean, if an assistant, if their job is to hold the suction, that really isn't a recipe for a long-time fulfilled assistant in your practice, is it?
100%. I think the old management method is, you know, this is the job description, you do what this says, but I think that doesn't work. As opposed to, like, you use DISC, I use a Kobe. You want to find out what people's strengths are, who they are. The more you know about them, craft a role that makes them jump out of bed and come to work because they love it. Like, for example, someone loves people, they should be on the phone. Someone doesn't, they shouldn't be on the phone. You know, like, simple. But a lot of times we don't really take the time to understand our people, their strengths, their tendencies, and we don't tap into them.
For example, two of our assistants wanted to go to the hygiene school. They had aspirations, and we encouraged them to go to hygiene school. Right. Now, that may sound kind of, well, Gary, you're going to lose them for 2 years while they're in hygiene school. Yeah, but we want to develop each team member. And this happened at different times, but I said to each one of these team members, we're excited about you going down. We're going to miss you, but we're excited about you going to hygiene school. But the only thing I request is that when you graduate from hygiene school, you come back into our practice as a hygienist. And guess what they did, Merritt? They both did.
Makes sense.
Both of them said, well, Gary, after working at LifeSmiles, I wouldn't want to work anywhere else.
Yeah, we care about those who care about us.
I found out how many days a week they were interested in working. And I said, well, now the job's on me to develop a hygiene department enough to bring them back into our practice as a hygienist. And we did that. So make it your mission to help develop each team member. Number five, embrace transparency. Naren, transparency is a very strong quality among leaders. When leaders are transparent, it elicits following and support. So embrace transparency. If you make a mistake, talk about it transparently. Talk about what you did, what you learned, and what you can do differently next time. Transparency is a wonderful quality. I think it's one of the most important qualities. Integrity and transparency, I think, are equally important qualities of very effective leaders. And if you're going to develop a high-performance team, you've got to develop your leadership skills, Doctor. There's no getting around that. Number six, invest in your team members. Here's some ideas. Regular team meetings where we're constantly bringing education in. They could be, practical work sessions where they're learning new skills. But regular team meetings, semi-annual team meetings, where we invest in our team to learn more new skills. Taking the team to an annual conference, a CE conference together as a team. And maybe something simple as you're doing individual check-ins with your team members, you might say something like this. Madi, is there anything on your practice wish list that you would like? Is there anything material that I can do to support you? Is there anything you need? What's on your wish list? I mean, it might be as simple as, I sure wish we had an extra printer. It seems like the one printer we have is always backed up and there's a queue for it. I sure wish. Do you think we could solve that wish list, Naren?
Absolutely.
It doesn't necessarily involve a lot of investment, but it's being tuned into what they need. Or maybe something as simple, this actually came up and we solved this one instantly, said, this chair doesn't work for me, one of our admin team members. She said, I have long legs and my legs are constantly rubbing up against the bottom of the counter. I had no idea. Let's go get a new chair. Let's go together. And get a new chair, right? We can go do that. How does that make someone feel when we fulfill that wish?
Oh, you know, very happy. They feel like you care, you listen.
Yeah, you heard that. You heard that. So make it a habit of, hey, when you're doing check-ins, how can I support you? What else can I do? What could I do that would, make your work life better for you? It might be as simple as a stapler. Okay, we can do that. We can do that. Number seven, model the behaviors from yourself that you expect from your team members. Think about that for just a minute. Model the behaviors yourself that you expect from your team members. One of the really cool things I notice when I see strong leader dentists is they're willing to do anything in the practice. Nothing is beneath them in terms of if it needs to be done, they can jump in and do it. And it models the whatever it takes attitude. When the doctor will take the trash out because it was overflowing and needed to be taken out and he or she had a moment to do it, they take the trash out. Then the team members instantly follow behind and it's like whatever it takes becomes their motto. whatever it takes to do the job. So model the behaviors that you expect. Modeling is the best form of changing behavior. And when you're modeling it, they want to do the same thing. Very, very important. Number eight, create a safe environment for correction. You're inevitably going to need to correct team members. Create a safe environment for that, where team members feel like they're not constantly being criticized, where correction is just part of the flow of being better tomorrow than we are today. But very often, the environment isn't set up that way. The way I like to think about this is like think of your bank account, where we have deposits and withdrawals, deposit and withdrawals. You've got to have enough deposits before you take a withdrawal. Well, think of it in terms of compliments and praise on the deposit side before we have to take corrections on the withdrawal side. So make it your daily activity to catch team members doing things well and compliment them so that in the future, when you need to make corrections, they don't feel like all you ever do is focus on the negative stuff. You never catch me doing anything good. Mm-hmm. It's a more balanced scenario, and fosters the idea of lifelong learning. And number nine, look for, this is an extension of what I just said, look for opportunities to praise your team members and praise them as specifically as possible. I also have an axiom that kind of goes along with that, something for you to remember. You want to praise in public and correct in private. So, for example, if your assistant took a great set of x-rays on a patient where it was maybe difficult to get a good set of x-rays, compliment that team member in front of your patient. Maya, these x-rays are perfect. They've given me all the information I need. Thank you. Now, if you're the patient sitting in the chair, how does that feel? How does that sound to the ears of the patient?
You know, the patient, you know, is happy that he or she is at that practice, right? Because
you guys got it together.
Yeah, exactly. And also, I think it shows, I mean, we like nice people. I mean, who likes a mean, nasty person, right? Like, do you want to hang out with somebody who's mean and nasty? It's just human nature. Like,
patients will leave a practice because of tension.
Right.
I don't mean tension on them. Yeah. I mean, interpersonal tension among doctor and team members or team members and team members. Right. People will leave because they don't want any part of that. They don't want to be around it.
Yeah, they don't want to be around it. Yeah.
But when they hear you complimenting the team, they feel like, I love coming here. This is a cool place. Well, let me recap those eight tips. In fact, I actually threw in a ninth one.
A bonus.
Threw in a bonus, but I called it eight tips because essentially nine was an extension of eight. Number one, create a very strong practice purpose and let your team members know what it is and live it and model it each and every day. Number two, cultivate a practice culture. If you're not developing culture, culture is developing on its own, and it may not be what you want. So you got to grab that ball and be the quarterback of that one. Number three, develop a genuine connection with each and every one of your team members. Number four, make it your mission to help develop each team member. Number five, embrace transparency. Transparent leaders are effective leaders. Number six, invest in your team members in the form of regular team meetings, semi-annual team meetings, taking the team to annual CE conferences, and consider asking each team member to keep a wish list of things that they could need or want that would improve their work life. Number seven, model the behaviors you expect from your team members. And number eight, create a safe environment for correction. An extension of number eight, by looking for opportunities to praise your team members as specifically as possible, any chance you can. All right, Naren, those are the eight tips to developing a high-performance team. Hope this has been helpful for you as a listener. We've got some great questions coming up to continue the conversation.
Here are the questions for the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment, Gary, that I have for you. By the way, I enjoyed this. You know, it's a little bit long, coaching and action segments, but I really enjoyed it because I think our listeners are going to get a lot of value from it. Eight tips to developing a high-performance team. Let me read each question one by one. This came from our audience from around the world. The first one is, I have what I think is a very solid team. However, some of my team members are not as driven as others. How can I help motivate my less motivated team members?
What a great question. And, I think it's fair to say that that could be a reality in virtually every dental practice, literally every dental practice, because to assume that everybody would have the same motivation level, I think is inaccurate. Some people are more driven by nature. Naren, I am OCD on drive.
Yes.
I am absolutely OCD on drive. I'm wired that way. I'm highly competitive. I am very goal-oriented. And, you know, I run my life on to-do lists. It drives some people crazy. It works for me, but I'm very driven. But one of the best ways you can do that is to understand more about the fundamental personality style of your team members. And the best way to do that, I like the DISC, the D-I-S-C personality styles. I know you like Colby. Colby's also a very good one. There's any number of different testing instruments. There's left brain, right brain. There's red, yellow, or excuse me, red, blue. Red, blue is another one. Left brain, right brain. They all operate on a similar principle of how the brain works and how one side of the brain is geared towards more of our creative activities and the other side of the brain is geared more towards the analytical side of our activities. So the best way to motivate your less motivated team members, for example, if you were to use DISC, there, maybe we could put the two episodes that we've done on DISC. The first one was an episode I did with Chris Licurdo, probably yes. Considered by many the world's foremost expert on the DISC personality styles. And then later, you and I did an interview on how we can use DISC effectively in your practice. Let's put those in the show notes. So if you go to thrivingdentist.com, click on podcast and scroll down to this episode, you'll find links to those two episodes in the show notes for this episode. So when you do the DISC test, you'll get a report back that is 18 pages long, 19 pages long. And one of the segments of the report will explain to you how best to motivate someone that has this personality style. So instead of trying to use a one size fits all, you will actually have a very specific set of guidelines to follow to motivate this particular person. So rather than, you know, just trying to assume that everybody's the same, you'll now learn how to motivate an individual team member on your practice based on their personality style. So I would recommend you go there and then also model your own. Model the fact that you are always wanting to be better tomorrow than you are today. And that might motivate some team members as well.
Yeah, just a couple of quick points, because I work with 215 or 220 plus people now. And I use DISC, I use Colby to understand people. And also, you communicate very frequently. So if you're key leaders, you need to have, cadence like once a week or once every 2 weeks, and you need to have a clear agenda. So you're not just jumping all over the place, but you need to know what your plan is and just discuss it. Anyways, those are the two things I would add, Gary. But
yeah, absolutely.
Some of my team members are not willing or able to travel to a conference or CE event. This is my question number two. Any ideas on alternative ways to embrace lifelong learning?
You know, that may be a reality for some people. Some people don't have the home situation where they can travel. Perhaps they don't have daycare for kids. Perhaps they don't have a family support system to pick up kids from school and that sort of thing. So certainly understand and try to be non-judgmental about that. Their circumstances, they may not have the level of support that you have. However, there's lots of ways to embrace lifelong learning. For example, you can subscribe to online CE, and you can make that online CE available to your team members. And you could even incorporate that online CE in team meetings, in your regular team meetings, in your semi-annual team meetings, you can incorporate that. You can incorporate book club in your practice. You don't have to travel for book club. You can do book club in your practice, where you choose a book, you read it together or listen it together as a team, and then you have a session around talking about what did we learn in that book and what can we apply in our practice. So it doesn't have to involve travel. In our own coaching work, Naren, our 24 systems, we have created resources, video resources in each one of those 24 systems. And those resources can be included, in your regular team meetings to drive these systems installation in your practice. So lots of different ways this can be done that doesn't involve travel. You have to be a little bit creative about it, but respect the fact that they may not be in a position where they can do that. But we can incorporate lifelong learning in a different way.
Thank you, Gary. Question number three. We have never discussed numbers in my practice, and I have concern that If I do so, it will seem like we are more about numbers and money than patient care. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I have heard that many, many, many times. Here, I just don't like to talk about numbers because I don't want to seem like we're all about numbers. I get that. And your why should not be about numbers. You know, remember we talked about, the first step to developing a high-performance team is create a very strong practice purpose.
Yes.
Practice purpose is all about numbers. I'm going to suggest that it's going to ring a little hollow. It's going to be a little bit flat. However, once we establish what your practice purpose is about, and I mean establish to the point where every team member can articulate it in their own words. I don't mean reading from a mission statement, but I mean, you know, they need to be able to articulate your purpose in their own words. If they were to run into an old friend, imagine, you know, one of the cool things about social media today, Naren, is we can connect with people that used to be part of our lives and then they kind of disappeared. And imagine meeting an old friend that wants to get updated. What are you doing these days? So I'm working in a dental practice. I'm an admin team member in a dental practice. What's your practice about? If they could express to that old friend what their practice is about and what the practice purpose is about, then that's accomplishing that goal of having a strong why, a strong purpose. So I think once you have that purpose established, we can then come back and talk about numbers, because the numbers are simply a way to measure how we're doing. And that's how I would focus it with the team. The practice is not about the numbers, but the numbers are a way to measure how we're doing. And they become very important in our practice because they can allow us to see how we're doing and where we can improve. So the numbers should never be the why, because if we start looking, you or your team members start looking at your patients as, you know, the next Panorex payment, or you're looking at the patient's dollar sign, then something is woefully wrong in your practice. We need to have a much stronger why. However, once that's established, then we can talk about the numbers, and we can talk about the numbers as a way to measure how we're doing. And the cool thing about doing that is, doctor, if you're the only one that understands the behind the scenes and the numbers of the practice, you don't have people that can help you get there. And if you don't have people that can help you get there, you're not likely to get there. It feels like you're pulling the wagon all by yourself. And there's a difference between pulling the wagon and having your team push you along towards higher levels of performance. And I believe, remember that one of the qualities I said of a high performance team, or one of the tips, was transparency.
Yes.
This is part of being transparent. We're transparently sharing the numbers of the practice with the team, confidentially, of course, but we're sharing it with the team, empowering the team to use this information to help you achieve the goals. My thoughts on sharing numbers. I think you should. But do it in such a way where it's very clear that your practice purpose is about enhancing the oral health and overall health of your patients and changing their lives. And the numbers are simply a way to measure how we're doing.
Yeah, I mean, I love numbers, Gary, as you know. And I think what numbers do for me is once I know what it is, then I can improve it. So let's say my conversion rate, right? A simple example, like what percentage of my calls am I converting? If I know it's 50% or even 80%, I know where I stand, and hey, then I can see, yeah, can I improve it or not? So without numbers, it's hard to, you know, make improvements.
It becomes very abstract if we don't have numbers.
Right.
It becomes anecdotal. How are we doing with this? Well, we think we're doing okay. But
yeah,
we have a way to measure it and monitor. You know, I love the quote, came from Bill Bowerman, the legendary track coach of the University of Oregon. Things that are measured improve. Things that are measured improve. So remember the wisdom, Coach Bowerman.
The fourth question, Gary, I have difficulty correcting team members. So as a result, I avoid it. I know intellectually that avoidance is not an effective strategy, and I need to overcome my avoidance. Any tips or suggestions?
Well, you're on your way, doctor, in recognizing that this is something you need to do. You need to overcome your avoidance. Avoidance is not likely to produce a favorable result. because the whatever you're trying to correct will simply continue because the team member has no idea that what they're doing isn't aligned. So avoidance is very difficult. You know, it's also useful to take a look at your own personality type. For example, in the DISC, someone that's a high S, one of the characteristics were of the four different qualities, S is the highest. By the way, a lot of dentists are high S. S's do not like conflict. They'll walk 100 miles around. They're conflict avoiders. They'll walk 100 miles around a conflict, then deal with it. And that may be part of the issue. But again, I'm going to come back to some of the things that I said in the coaching and action segment. Remember the deposits and withdrawals. One of the best ways that you can more successfully address corrective measures with team members is to have lots of deposits in the banks of genuine compliments where you're specific with the team member. You know, it's one thing for you to say, Maria, you did a good job today. And Maria will feel warm and fuzzy about that. But it evaporates pretty quickly because it's not very specific. But imagine if you were able to say, maybe Maria is a hygienist, and maybe you overheard a conversation that Maria had with her patients, with a particular patient that afternoon, about their periodontal health. And imagine you overheard that in the hallway. At the end of the day, you went to Maria and say, Maria, I want to take a minute and compliment you. I think it was mid-afternoon, you had a patient in your chair, and you were talking about her periodontal health. And first of all, the words that you used were fantastic. But even more important than the words was the tone that you had as you were talking to the patient. And I can only imagine that if I was that patient, I would feel that you cared very deeply about me. Your tone was one of caring and compassion. And your tone was fantastic. And I just want to take a minute and compliment you for that conversation you had with that patient. Well, I'm sure it wasn't easy to have the conversation. Your words were perfect and your tone was even more perfect. Thank you. Now imagine how that compliment will resonate with a team member. Even better, you know, because it's very specific. It's not just you had a good day, but you did something very specific. And what's likely to continue? That team member is likely to repeat the things that she was praised on before. Well, I do have a very specific reference for you in correcting team members. It's from the book, and it's a Ken. You remember the Ken Blanchard book that we did in book club, Naren?
Yes.
Ken Blanchard has written a really terrific book called The 1 Minute Manager. And there is a chapter in the book called The 1 Minute Reprimand, And I would encourage you all to read it. You can read it in about 4 minutes, that chapter. It's very concise. And I would encourage you to follow the wisdom of Ken Blanchard. Naren, maybe we can put a link in the show notes, an Amazon link for that book, The 1 Minute Manager.
Right.
I won't go through the full steps of it. I'll let Ken do that himself. But at the very end, he finishes with this. Naren, let's say you were the team member and I was needing to correct you for whatever reason. And they'd end that conversation. The manager or leader would end the conversation by saying something like this. And Naren, I have 100% confidence in you that when you have an opportunity to reflect on our conversation, you're going to make the necessary changes that will make you more effective in your job. And now we close on a very positive note. So maybe it's tactical that you don't know how to correct. And that book, The 1 Minute Manager by Ken Blanchard, and the chapter, The 1 Minute Reprimand, will provide you that information to be able to do that more effectively. Well, Naren, as we bring this this episode to a conclusion, the 8 tips to developing a high-performance team. It's not something you can just click your fingers and be done with. It is something you have to be continually working on. But let me bring it back full circle and remind you that I've yet to meet a world-class practice that didn't also have a high-performance team. And I want to encourage you. I believe that each and every one of our listeners can, in fact, develop a high-performance team. It's not going to be easy, but it's definitely going to be worthwhile. On that note, let me thank you, Naren, and your team at Equa for all that you do to support Life Smiles, but also to support our clients in developing effective marketing. If you're a new listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you have the opportunity to schedule a marketing strategy meeting with Equa, where you can learn how your website looks in the eyes and mind of Google, and some things that you can do to improve website performance and search engine optimization so that you can get on page one more frequently when someone's looking for a dentist in your community. You can go to Equa, www.equaekw.com /MSM, marketing strategy meeting, and you can schedule that marketing strategy meeting. Normally, there's a fee involved in that. However, Naren's been kind enough to waive that fee to any of the listeners of the Thriving Dentist Show. On that note, let me simply thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you that Naren and I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.